Good morning, everyone who is watching this live interview with the great Carol Jarvis today. Thanks so much for tuning in. And before we go any further, I want to thank my sponsors, Euclid IQ, the world's leader in audio and video compression, as well as Dylan Music. And if you go to dylanmusic.com, you can have a 5% discount if you just use the code Dylan5. So without any further ado, Carol, it's a pleasure to see you.
Well, pleasure to be here. Thank you. Well, I'm here, but I'm here as well.
Exactly. The miracles of technology. So, Carol, I want to, before we get going a lot into your career, I want to talk about your beginnings and how you came to the trombone and how all that started.
Yeah, of course. So I first came to the trombone because I passed a music test aged about 10 or 11 at school, just to be able to distinguish what notes are flatter or sharper. And apparently I scored the top. So they said that they took me to one side and said, right, okay, you can choose any instrument, but we want you to play the oboe. So I went home to my parents and I said, what's an oboe? They played me some recordings and apparently I turned my nose up and said, no, absolutely not. Which now I know is like, yeah, that's I had a good sense of of sound even back then. No offense to oboe players. I'm sure it can sound nice. Apparently then I said to my dad, what's the one that goes like that? I've no idea where I'd seen one before. I've no idea who had influenced me to even know what, I don't know. I've no idea. But my dad said that's a trombone, found me some recordings. And I think they played me clips of George Chisholm, some sort of Tommy Dorsey stuff, and some orchestral repertoire. And I just heard the full spectrum. And I said, yeah, absolutely. That's it. That's the instrument for me. My parents got me this this cheap secondhand trombone, just a student model, which I ended up using as like a jazz, my first ever little small bore for many, many years. They got this little student model and there was a tune a day book. I don't know how my parents had these books, but they had quite a few of them, really, really old books, and I grabbed it and I said, right, okay, I just got stuck in straight away. Before even I had a first lesson, I worked out how to make a noise, I worked out how to read a note, I worked out how to play a scale, and then I went to my first trombone lesson. And my lessons were with, in the UK here, you usually sort of start sort of 20 minute lessons and you share the lesson with two other players. So it's me and two cornet pupils with a cornet teacher. And there were no trombone teachers in the area. So I was learning from cornet method books and with all the valve fingerings above the notes. But I'd learned where the positions were, so I was fine. I just went from there, really. So little did I know, I was learning all the valve fingerings ready for euphonium doubling later on. I'd learned all the valve fingerings without really realizing, without even playing a valve instrument while I was learning the trombone. I grew up in a Milton Keynes music service, which is just sort of north of London. The music service there at the time was absolutely phenomenal. So I gained a county music scholarship, which gave me piano lessons. And then I was, because there were no trombone players around, I was in brass bands, orchestras, big bands, improvisation classes, composition classes, musicianship classes, right from the start. Saturday mornings were the music school, and that started at sort of 8 o'clock in the morning right through to about 2:30, 3 o'clock in the afternoon. Just rehearsal, all sorts of things in there, everything from orchestral to big bands and everything. And then Monday nights was choir, Tuesday nights was brass band, Wednesday night was one of the orchestras, Thursday night was a chamber orchestra, Friday night was brass quintet. So that was every evening as well. So basically I'd finish school about 3:30, 4 o'clock, go home, have a bite to eat, straight back out to rehearsals, get home about 10 o'clock at night every evening. So how I fitted in my schoolwork, I don't really know, but I think that was Sunday.
Wow.
But because of that and just being submerged into every style of music right from the start, just set me up for life, and I'm still doing all of it. So brass bands, well, not so much brass bands these days, but orchestras, big bands, session work, all sorts. Yeah. So, yeah.
That's an amazing setup that I think would be uncommon in most places, especially here in the US. That wouldn't happen as much, you know.
Yeah, I think with arts funding cuts and things, I mean, that music service now is still in existence, but nowhere near the kind of thing that we had. So I feel very, very lucky.
And I think that's the thing, too, with so many European musicians. I think they're more versatile than we are in some ways. I mean, in London especially, there's like, it seems to be so much more of a freelance kind of thing where you have to do more things.
I mean, I guess because London is so small, but there's so much going on in there. Yeah. I mean, you've got all the sort of Broadway shows, they're all in the West End in London, so many of them. And then you've got, I mean, how many orchestras? An awful lot of professional orchestras just in London. And then you've got music conservatoires. You've got, what, 4 or 5 music conservatoires in London. And then there's the big band scene and the jazz clubs, and there's so much all packed into London.
Yeah.
The freelance scene, obviously, I mean, that's the place to be. I think because the UK is so small as well, though, I mean, I studied music up in Manchester, which is probably 2 or 3 hours away from London. There's a few professional orchestras in Manchester. There's one in Birmingham. There's some in Cardiff, Bournemouth. They're spread all over the place and up in Scotland. But if you're freelancing, the main place to freelance is definitely London. But yeah, you can absolutely position yourself all over the place to freelance.
So who were you listening to when you were growing up playing the trombone? Who were your big influences that you listened to?
I think trombone-wise, I think my jazz heroes have got to be Tommy Dorsey, Emmy Green, Frank Rossellino, Dick Nash. They're all kind of my jazz heroes. And then in terms of, I think Christian Lindbergh has always got to be one of the first ever. He was the one that brought the trombone to the front of the stage, really, right. Classical-wise. So what he did for our instrument is just phenomenal. So I can't escape all those recordings, so many of them as well. But then, I mean, in the likes of sort of Ian Bousfield, his playing, his recordings, Jürgen van Rijn, his sound, unbelievable. Joe Aletti, they're absolutely my classical heroes that I listen to. And it's the sound quality and the tone and also the technique is just, they've made the trombone look very easy.
Yeah, and it always sounds easy when they play too, right?
Yeah.
So easy. Were you transcribing jazz as a student when you were younger?
You know, transcription wasn't really something we did very much of, but it's kind of something I learnt on the gig.
Mm-hmm.
So I remember we had some brass arranging classes when I was at a music conservatoire, but that only lasted for 1 year. So we had a little bit of arranging, but then after that I've done an awful lot of string arranging, which might sound strange, but like for the likes of Corinne Bailey Ray, her last 3 albums I've written the strings and arranged those. One of them's a Grammy award winning album, Mercury Music Award albums and stuff. But then when I toured with Seal for 6 years, he basically had all his big numbers, Kiss from a Rose, Crazy, all these amazing numbers that he'd done in the past. But he brought in a horn section.
Mm-hmm.
And so it was my job to transcribe and arrange parts for the horn section. And so I worked up the whole pad for the touring show. But then when we were on gigs, and like, for instance, we were doing a live TV show in Paris once. And it was a bit like quite a few artists taking turns performing, and he knew one of the other artists. He said, "Hey, how are you? Hey, great, let's do a duet." And I was like, "Uh-oh, I know, this is my job." He was like, "Yeah, let's do a duet. Let's do a Beatles number." Okay, great. And I had 1 hour to go away, find a recording. Thankfully, iTunes was around. Download the recording, transcribe it, arrange 4 horn parts, add it in the cues for the guitar and stuff like that, arrange it all, print it, and go live on TV. 1 hour to do all of that. So I basically just got quicker and quicker and quicker at it, but because I had to.
Yeah.
I didn't study it, didn't learn it, but now through teaching, I'm absolutely saying it's a really useful skill.
Wow, that's amazing. And kind of going back to your education, you studied at the Royal Northern College in Manchester, correct? Can you talk about your teachers there? I know you had two teachers. Can you talk about what you got from each of them that was such a strong influence with you?
Yeah, Chris Holding was one of my teachers. He was then principal trombone in Opera North. And he was very much really, really good for me arriving as a big fish in a small pond to being a small fish in a big pond and sorting out any technique problems. He was very much technique based. And also my other main teacher was Andy Berryman, who was principal trombone in the Halle Orchestra at the time. And he was very much sort of the finished article and the artistic side and the performance. And he really gave me that sort of the flair of just getting up there and really being able to perform. And I also had lessons from John Iveson, who was in the LSO. So I had such a really good bit of everything in those teachers. And I managed to get a few other lessons with other players at the time, but they were my main teachers.
So after college, what did you break into first? Was it the pop stuff, or were you getting calls to play in orchestras more?
It's a 4-year course. I did 5 years because I was a student union president. You have to take a year out to organize all the student activities and things, but I got a whole year extra of lessons. So I actually studied for 5 years. It was my first year I started picking up professional orchestral work. I started working with the Halle Orchestra freelance. And then I think by my second year I was working with the BBC Philharmonic freelance, a little bit with Royal Liverpool Philharmonic and Opera North. And then my third year, some orchestral jobs started being advertised. So I then was on trial with the BBC National Orchestra of Wales and on trial with the BBC Symphony Orchestra. The jobs were kind of a bit like musical chairs. Everyone started moving and retiring all at the same time. So lots and lots of jobs came up in the UK.
Yeah.
And so I went for every single one of them. And luckily, touch wood, it was all going so well for me. And I got a trial with every single one of them. So by the time I graduated, my freelance career was already completely full. I think normally it's kind of, you've got to find a bit of teaching, you've got to try and find your way into freelancing. But because I'd done trials in the last 2 or 3 years at college, that got me on the extra work list for all of the orchestras. So right. I was getting up and down the country with all of that. And alongside that, I was starting to sit in on some West End shows and quite a lot of big band work as well. And the Blackpool Tower was a main place where we did a lot of, in the ballroom there, lots of big band shows. So yeah, it was just busy.
Wow. Yeah, your calendar sounds incredibly busy. So that's why I'm so glad you found some time today to do this. So when did you start doing some more of the recording session work? Did that kind of creep in as you were doing both of all these different things?
Yeah, I think it just does just gradually creep in as you get known a bit more. I think it's kind of, I don't know, you just keep your head down and you carry on with whatever you're doing. And it's the people you're working with eventually call upon you for more work. And so going into all the studios and doing the session work is probably my most favourite side of everything I do. But also I got myself a recording set up at home. Big desk here, you can't see it, but it's very big. All the recording gear, a few expensive microphones and audio interfaces and things. But I got into that probably 15, 20 years ago.
Yeah.
Just because I'm interested in sort of tech side of things anyway.
Yeah.
And I'm really thankful I did because me and a trumpet player, we set up something called Real Brass. You can check out the website, realbrass.co.uk. And we provide horn section stuff or classical stuff for TV adverts, films, game soundtracks, DJ soundtracks, all sorts of things that we record from our home studios. And as soon as the pandemic hit, everyone's setting up their own studio. But luckily, people knew that I had this studio, so that's when things really got quite busy. Quite a few TV adverts came in, and but I've just been so lucky with all that. And also, I just set up voiceover work maybe 2-3 years ago now.
Yeah.
Because I had all the gear, got a little vocal booth, I decided, right, I'll put together a few little demos, sent them off, got an agent straight away, and I've done TV adverts, things for Amazon, and all sorts of things now. So, and again, I'm so glad I set that up before the pandemic hit, because obviously studios closed and everyone needed voiceover artists that had a home studio. So that suddenly got very busy. I've just done a nature documentary series, which is a very long audio book as well. 16 hours of it.
You sound like you probably never rest. Like your days must be 12-hour days pretty often.
You know what? People ask me, what's your hobby? And I'm like, I do that for my living. That's how, I don't know.
Yeah.
Surely people always strive to do their hobby for a living or find something that they love so much. So, yeah, all my spare time is this as well. So. Yeah.
Well, and talking about the recording a little bit, I mean... do you remember because some of those studios in London are so iconic. Of course, Angel just closed not too long ago, but like Abbey Road and places like this that you grew up as a child knowing about because of obvious recordings that had gone on there, the Beatles, so many other things that happened. Do you remember the first time you walked into that setting and you thought, wow, I'm really doing this in this place. What's this all about?
Yeah, definitely pinched myself for the first Abbey Road session. I think most of the time it's Studio One with the big orchestra. That's the bigger studio, much, much bigger. But they're literally next door to each other, and the cafe is just beyond that. So you walk in, down the corridor, down the stairs, and it's just all there. And you walk past all the gear. You walk past all the old pianos and all the desks, and they're all lining in the corridors. But if you're on Studio One, you guarantee you'll know everyone in Studio 2 as well. And yeah. Then there's the cafe and then the outside area where everyone just hangs out. And it's such a great atmosphere in there. Every time I'm in there, it's just, hey, hi. It's just brilliant. It's such a great place.
It's amazing. And talk a little bit about subbing with these major orchestras, because I know you've gotten called to do some last minute things. Was Ian playing in the LSO when you were subbing there some?
No, Ian had left by then. I can't remember who was. No, it was Dudley and Katie were in the LSO then when I started going in. I was meant to be going in with them this week, actually, but sessions got cancelled. Never mind.
In addition to all this amazing other stuff you're doing, somehow you find time to tour when there's not a pandemic going on. Because you played with... Yeah. You played with Sting, which we want to talk. I want to talk about Sting in particular in a little bit, and Queen, Michael Bublé, Seal. We talked about Rod Stewart, Harry Connick, just so many people. Michael Bolton. Can you talk about touring with these guys? What are some of the differences in some of the acts? Like, what is it like to play with Queen versus what's it like to play with Sting, for example?
Well, everyone's so different. I mean, there's some stars who, I don't know, they're quite detached to the band and quite detached to the musicians and the crew and things. That's more their sort of focus, I think, so that they stay focused on tour and they look after, they've got to look after their voices, they've got to look after themselves. Whereas some artists just want to be with the band, be with the crew. And I love that about touring with Seal. We did Around the World several times with Seal. He always wanted to be with the band. So if it was a tour across the States, Route 66, right, east to west, he wanted to be on the tour bus with us. And that was it, which was fantastic. And then I guess when you're doing places like, I don't know, Australia, and it's much bigger, so you can't do it by tour bus, so it's got to be flights and stuff. He'll make sure that we're all with him all the time, which is lovely, really lovely. Whereas some stars, I mean, the Queen thing, that was only like 2 or 3 gigs with them. Obviously, Freddie Mercury wasn't around anymore. But I mean, Brian May, everyone was just like, oh my God, it's Brian May. but just sweet as anything. It's just, it's so funny to sort of look at these people and think, am I starstruck? Well, actually, no, because they're just a human being and they're just sweet as anything. They're just humble and lovely. And it always sort of struck me, especially with sort of the top session players as well. It's like, oh my God, you've played on every soundtrack, you've played on everything. But I know you are allowed to have an ego, but normally 9 times out of 10, maybe 10 times out of 10, all these top people are the most humble people you'll meet. And it's the people that are trying to get up there, the people that have got the ego. And I always find that everyone's just been absolutely lovely. And I know you know about my sort of illness. And I went through a lot of illness for a long time. But I was touring with Michael Bolton for a few years. I went about 3 years with Michael. And he took me to one side one day and said, tell me all about it. Tell me all the details. I said, oh, okay. So I told him all about it. And at that point, things weren't looking good for me. And my prognosis had hit rock bottom, but I was still touring. And I was just trying to find some new specialists and some new treatments elsewhere. And he said, keep me posted. If there's any financial things, keep me posted. Which was amazing to have that sort of, luckily I didn't have to ask, just so, so sweet. And then on tour with Seal, I mean, he would fly me home on a day off to have a blood transfusion or a scan or something and fly me back again, which again, he could have just got someone else. It wasn't such a burden, but he was just as sweet as anything. I think what I do love about the touring lifestyle is it's just a family. Once you're in it, it's a real family, close-knit thing. Everyone looks after each other, which is just lovely.
We'll definitely get back to your issues with cancer in a bit, because that's such a huge component of your story, and it's also so inspiring how you got through it. Of all these acts we just talked about, these obviously talking about Seal and Michael Bolton being so kind, what are some of the funniest things that have ever happened on some of these tours that you can talk about publicly?
Ooh, yeah, there's some non-disclosure agreements that I've seen.
Right, exactly. Sure.
Some funny things. You put me on the spot there. I do remember on tour with Sting, I just finished some radioactive treatment. I'd just been locked away in a lead-lined room for 9 days, and they injected this highly radioactive clinical trial experimental drug. And a man with a Geiger counter came to the doorway every day, held this Geiger counter at me, and just measuring how radioactive I was. And I got a video on my phone. I don't believe I'm radioactive. I feel absolutely fine. It's in my bloodstream, and I'm locked in this room. And I videoed him in a doorway saying, well, how radioactive is a normal person? And he says, about 0.01 on the Geiger counter. I said, okay, so what am I today? He said, you're 65, you're not coming out. I said, okay, okay. Because I was a danger to be amongst people. So as soon as I got out, I think I had then a month before I was allowed to be close proximity to anyone. I had to be 2 meters away from people. Mm-hmm. Like pandemic times, really. But 2 meters away from people for the next month, especially pregnant women. And but during that time, I went on tour with Sting. And so on stage, I was like, I've got to tell everyone that I can't sit next to you. But everyone said, don't care. Okay. Okay. And I warned Sting when I said, do you mind if I have a photo with you? And they said, yeah, but can I just tell you, I'm radioactive. What? So I told him about it. And he said, yeah, put his arm around me. So he's just like, okay, that's fine. Yeah. So that's one crazy stories. I was radioactive while I was touring with Sting.
Yeah.
But yeah, I can't think of, hilarious.
Anything publicly hilarious, right?
I think touring with Steel, I ended up playing keyboards and singing backing vocals quite a lot. Sorry.
It's okay.
And hang on. And while I was playing, I was learning the keyboard part because the main keyboard player said, right, Carol, you play keys. Let me teach you this part. We need another keys player tonight. Okay. So we're on the tour bus and he gave me this little USB keyboard, sort of an octave, and said, right, so it starts in G minor and then he's just doing these two fingers on this keyboard on the tour bus on the way to the sound check. Okay, so yeah. And then the chorus, yeah, I remember how that sounds, yeah. And that's that. Okay. And he said, we got to sound check. He said, right, okay, so this is the keyboard now. So you'll be miming on the gig just for tonight. So just you can turn that, you can press that, all that will be off, and all of it will be off. So just look cool. That's all you got to do. Okay, great. And so I came to the gig, in-ear monitors, ran around from the other side, put my trombone down, ran around this side, onto the keyboard. He went onto the bass guitar and said, go for it. And he went off his bass guitar onto the, like, right, okay, I remember how this goes. So I was like, I can't just do that. It's G minor. So here we go, G minor. And playing all the chords. And I, as I was playing, I was like, right, press that, turn that, press that, turn that. And he just said, it'll be off, don't worry. And then I got to the end of the number. And I was like, I can't remember how the last chord ends. Whether it's like a stab, or whether it's a pause, or how long it is. I can't really remember because I'm normally backstage. So I'll just hold this G minor chord. I was like, hang on. I'm going through the PA. That's me going through the PA. They'd finished. And I was holding this G minor chord and it was going through the whole PA. I was like, the bass guitarist came back and said, oh my God, I wasn't miming at all. No, you weren't. Oh my God. So it's kind of a good job I was paying attention to that little USB keyboard.
Yeah. So,
yeah. I mean, you can be put on the spot a few times on tour. So.
I guess so. You've done so much work and so much traveling with people like this and touring. What advice would you have for people who are doing road work that might not do it as often anything from how you practice on the road to things you make sure you bring with you, like your own pillow or things like that. What kind of things have you picked up over the years that you know you need to do on a tour to stay in the right kind of form?
I think it's so easy to just get caught up in the tour bubble. It's always called the bubble. You don't know what is on the news. You don't know what's going on at home. You don't know anything else outside this tour bubble. And I mean, it's such a lovely way of life. You get a day sheet under the door of your hotel room telling you what time to be at the bus and packed up your hotel room. And then you get the bus. You don't have to worry about wherever you are. You just get on the bus. You arrive at the sound check. You know what you're doing then, rehearsal, gig, back on the tour bus. And you don't need to worry about where you are. You just arrive in a different country or you arrive somewhere else. You check into another hotel room. You get another day sheet telling you what time to be back at the bus. And so it's just very, it's very simple, really. As long as you do the gig and the sound check all to the best of your ability, that's it. But one thing that's very important, I mean, the kind of different tour buses I've been on, for instance, there are some where the bunks are really nicely spaced out. And there's only sort of four or five of you on a bus. Sometimes they're much more close together and there's sort of 16 of you on a bus. And you could be in a row of sort of three bunks and everyone's snoring around you. So you need to be aware that you do need to get your rest. And occasionally you won't get much rest. We've been stuck in airports for sort of 16 hours waiting for a private jet. And 16 hours, what are you going to do? I mean, you've got to rest. You can't you've got to make the most of that time, and time zones and all sorts, there's going to be all sorts of things that you've got to be on form. So I think that's something, always, always get plenty rest. But then there's all sorts of crazy little tricks I've learned from other people on the road, like doing your laundry, all these tiny things. You can do it all in the sink, but then how do you dry it? Well, someone said, open a hotel desk drawer, put them in there, get the hairdryer on it. Ta-da! and then you sort of close the drawer and you've got a little tumble dryer. it's clever little things I learned. And now I remember there was a drummer came on tour with us. He packed, I think, 3 sets of clothes, and one of his suitcases, which was this size, had a mobile washing machine in it. And he just had 3 sets of clothes and a washing machine. Wow. Okay. I mean, people find different ways of coping on the road. And really clever.
Well, how about as far as practicing on the road? How does that stack up to when you're at home like normal?
Yeah, I think it's a lot harder. And then, I mean, I remember being in Mexico on tour, and the university had got in touch, knowing that there was a horn section coming, and the brass department wanted us to come and do a masterclass and things. So we went in, and me and my trumpet player friend went in and did some trios with a piano and some masterclasses and things. We were like, oh, that was really hard work, playing and stuff. And then we found out later it's because we're really high up above sea level. And it's like, that's why we're out of breath. And then also we played up in Zermatt in Switzerland. And again, the altitude is like, you can't actually catch your breath. So it's not just keeping that in practice and the lungs, but actually coping with the different places you're going to be as well. I remember one sound check in full sun in Milan. And the sound check was like 5 hours long, and we were just really suffering. It was just so, so hot. But sometimes sound checks is the time to get things right. So you've got a sound check could be 20 minutes long, it could be 5 hours long. You've got to be prepared for stamina wise, not just trombone playing or lip or lungs or altitude. You've got to be able to sustain that standing there in the heat outside amphitheatres and stuff. So I think it's just finding a quiet corner. There's always a gap between soundcheck and gig. There's normally a support act on, so you've got time for a support act. You can go find another room somewhere, and always take a practice mute and try and find a good practice mute that doesn't sort of disrupt the tone or anything, because there are some practice mutes out there that don't really help free blowing.
What's your preferred, is shush your, I saw that as maybe an endorsement or something, or maybe I see it behind you actually.
I know, you know what, I've just got one of the Rahano mutes, they're Rahano, and I think they're 3D printed, which is very clever. And I'm just sort of giving it a go. It's really nice. So yeah, shh, mute and one of those. They're my 2 favorites at the moment, I guess.
So now speaking of practice, what's your, if you're home, and you're not on the road, what's your normal practice routine like?
Always, no matter what I've got coming up in the diary, start slow and low and quiet. I think, especially you go to sort of all the music festivals, and there's people trying to play fast and loud and high. But actually, you can't do that well without doing the fundamentals. So it's always start with mouthpiece. Well, start with breathing, then mouthpiece, and then slow and low. Lip flexibility is quite normal, and then scales. I know when I was at college I hated scales, but now I love them. I think they're absolutely amazing. Scales are incredible, the amount of different forms, all the different modes, and there's so much, and if you can get yourself around all of those, then yeah, laughing really. So always look after the basics, always.
Yeah. How long does that normally take you if you're home and in not a rush situation?
It varies, really. I always make it different every day. Mm-hmm. So always making up different lip flexibilities, do different scales. But yeah, I mean, I don't ever want it to last longer than about 30 minutes. I want to be able to be on form after 30 minutes because that's roughly what I'll do when I turn up to something anyway. But yeah. I mean, the luxury of when you've got a bit of time is I'll keep warming up for an hour or two if I can. Get out some study books and I mean, yeah, there's so many study books out there and there's some amazing things and you can read everything differently. You don't have to read this legato study as legato every single time. You can work on your articulation, you can read it triple tonguing, you can read things in different ways. So it's just being creative with it all.
Are there books that you find yourself coming back to over and over, or do you really vary things a tremendous amount?
I'm always discovering new ones. I'm loving Brad Edwards at the moment. It's a bit of a favourite one for quite a few people at the moment. There's a couple of books and they're absolutely lovely.
Yeah.
But I mean, there's the standard ones. The Bordoni, the La Fosse. They do come back to those because, well, students have got those in their assessments and things anyway. So, and the box of studies are rock hard. And there's Telemann stuff. There's so much. I just like to vary it all the time.
Yeah. Are there, so speaking of pedagogy and teaching, how many students do you teach right now?
I teach at two conservatoires.
Okay.
I've got 1, 2, 3, 4 in London, and I've got 3, 4, 5 in Manchester, which is where I studied.
And so, what do you find work on those students with mostly? What are their interests? What direction do they want to take?
Oh, they're all so different, which is great. Some of them don't want to go into playing, which is almost heartbreaking because, I mean, some of them have just done their final recitals. I managed to watch live stream online and they were stunning. And if ever they're watching this, I really hope that they do do it because some of them want just to go into teaching, which is totally fair enough. But I think if you can carry on playing as well, then you've just got to keep, like I did, keep as many avenues open as possible, because I think that's how I've ended up staying, well, being able to sustain a career in music, is because I do a bit of everything. Jack of all trades, master of none, but still trying to master them all and faking it as best I can.
Anybody that's heard you play would probably argue with the last statement, but.
No, honestly, I'm still trying, but I think I'll always still be trying. I think there's no, you've mastered it. I don't, there's never that. There's always something more to learn, which is what I love about it. But yeah, I've got some students wanting to go off on cruise ships. I take quite a lot of the people that cross over the sort of jazz and classical. So it's really nice to be able to sort of, yeah, work with different areas, because I've done all the different areas. So
yeah,
it's really nice that people have got different interests.
Well, so, and then this is the part of the story we want to go to, which we've touched on a bit, but I believe it was 2004 you were diagnosed with Hodgkin's, correct?
Yeah.
Can you kind of talk about your journey with that? Because it obviously got very dire at certain points, and now that you've been in remission, I believe, since 2011, is that correct?
Yeah, 10 years this year, yeah.
Wow.
So yeah, 2004, it started off with a little lump just sort of here,
mm-hmm.
sort of that size. And I mean, anyone can just feel your neck and you'll feel tiny, tiny little things. It's not to worry about if they're that size, but it's when they get a little bit bigger and they normally come up and go down because they glands are everywhere. But this thing was just persistent. It was just there all the time. Saw a physio, and the physio said, "I don't like this or that." Sent me to my doctor, and doctor also said, "I don't like this or that." And I got a referral to ears, nose, and throat department in hospital. They did a needle biopsy to try and get some cells, and that came back saying they hadn't got any cancer cells, so it's most likely not cancer. but they said it's most likely HIV, hepatitis B or C, or typhoid. Okay, right. But then they took me in general anaesthetic and took a node out, and that's when it was diagnosed Hodgkin's lymphoma. And it wasn't until a scan, a full body scan to see if it spread anywhere, that they found that it was 15 centimeters round in between my lungs. So this size. And I said, hang on a minute, I'm a trombone player. How come I didn't know? And I said, you've got so much room in there, you wouldn't know. So that was just the indication that there was something much more sinister in there. So it was, chemo starts on Tuesday. Okay, how about kids and eggs and chemo starts on Tuesday? Okay. So that was just, that was it, bang, straight into chemotherapy. And I lost my hair 3 times throughout all the treatments. But this first treatment, this lump disappeared after about the fourth out of, I think it was 12 treatments. Like, oh, that's good, that's gone. Can't see what's going on here. But after the 6 months of back chemotherapy, they scanned and it was still in there. And I remember the chemotherapy nurse gave me this really tight hug and said, I'm so sorry. Because prognosis from this initial primary treatment is really good. Especially I was in my 20s and kind of, it's just really, really good chance of just all clear straight away, but I was one of the very few. And I said, oh, it's fine, don't worry, we'll get on to the next thing. And so they had a different chemotherapy and then a stem cell transplant and then some radiotherapy to here, which was like a rectangular shape here. And they said, unfortunately, we're going to clip your lungs. We're going to have to zap all of that. So you're going to lose 20% lung capacity. And I said, whoa, I'm a trombone player. And and I remember the specialist saying, Carol, this is your life. Yes, you get a combo. And I remember really noticing that lack of air.
Yeah.
Just losing all that lung capacity. I remember doing Pulse the Planets and sitting on second trombone and trying to keep up with the two guys either side of me. It's like, oh, this just feels so different.
Yeah.
But fast forward, I mean, it was then back-to-back treatments, just trying to find as much as they could. I exhausted all chemotherapy, radiotherapy, stem cell transplant. And then they were looking at clinical trial drugs, experimental drugs. But it was 2006, they started telling me, you've got to get your affairs in order. And you're not going to make it. And every time I went into hospital, they kept saying that, Carol, you're not going to make it. You're not going to survive. And I remember there was one appointment and they said, well, what's going on then? Why? I feel okay. What's going on? They said, in between your lungs, there's a 4 centimeter tumor. And I remember going, 4 centimeters? Pathetic. I was like, come on, I want some answers. I want to do something. What are we doing next? And he just said, Carol, it's 4 centimeters that is slowly killing you and we can't stop it. Right. Okay. And they sent me to psycho-oncologists to help me get my head around the fact that I was dying because I wasn't really coming to terms with it, or so they thought. I think I was a combination of in denial, but also quite determined at the same time. So, yeah, I mean, the psychologist did help me sort of get my head around the fact that I didn't really have a future ahead of me. But at the time I was touring, I was seeing the world, and I think subconsciously I was kind of making the most of those days, seeing the world, touring with my best friends in a tour bubble. There's no better life than that. Just being caught up in that. You've got no worries of the world. Yes, I had cancer on my shoulders, but I can forget about that while I'm on tour, and I can just make the most of whatever time I had left. And that's how I was living. And so it was then clinical trial drugs and experimenting. When something new came along, like I said, the lead-lined room, that was one of them. And that sadly didn't work. It was shortly after the Sting tour, I came out with a head to toe rash because of this radioactive thing. And I went into hospital and they said, we're very sorry. And I said, it's really painful. It was literally, you couldn't see my skin beyond the rash. I said, we're very sorry. I said, well, what can you do? I said, we've never seen this before. We don't know because it's so experimental. And I said, we'd just guess you're kind of being sunburnt from the inside outwards. Right. Thanks. Okay, I'll just go home and try and get better then. Yeah. But that's kind of signing up to experimental things because that's the only thing I had left. I had no other choice. It was either that or just resigning to it. And luckily, a clinical trial drug got me to remission. And it shocked all the specialists. And then I knew that was 2011, I got to remission. I remember knowing that I couldn't celebrate just yet because I knew my specialist said, okay, if you leave the remission as it is, we guess you live for about 3 years. Okay. It's so experimental. We don't know how long that remission will last. So we'll give you a month to decide whether to go for a bone marrow transplant or not. They looked for a donor and they found 2 matches out of 11 million people. One was pregnant, so they couldn't ask her in this month. And luckily this German man said yes. He went through all the blood tests and he was a perfect match. And he said, yes, he will be my donor. And so they gave me this month and they said, if you go for the transplant, and it's a 30% survival rate, if you go for the transplant and it works, that's your future open-ended. You could live for a ripe old age. If it doesn't work, like I said, it's a 30% survival rate. You could be dead within the first week or two or the first month or two. So it's just this month where I decided to live for 3 years and leave it as it was or go for it and potentially have a future, or it might not work. So I gave it my best shot and thankfully it all worked. But I mean, straight after that was 2011. Your DNA has got to change and your blood type has got to change. That normally happens within the first few months. For me, it didn't change for another 2.5 years. So I couldn't produce any blood for 2.5 years. So during all that time, I was having blood transfusions every 2 weeks for 2.5 years. I was touring again during that time, but I could only go so far before my blood count had dropped down to like 6, and oxygen won't get around your body. You can't walk upstairs. You can't breathe. You just can't do anything. And then I get topped up and then I can carry on again. So I was still just linked to the hospital for another 2.5 years. So it wasn't till sort of the end of 2013, 2014, that actually I got my life back. My blood type changed, my DNA changed. And ever since then, it's just, life is rosy.
What a perspective and a tough way to gain it. I mean, did you meet your bone marrow donor?
Yeah, so after 1 year post-transplant, you're allowed to send a message anonymously through the Anthony Nolan register, which is a register sort of Europe-based. And he was told, because he's in Berlin, he was told that he'd never hear from or hear whether who they donated to, who they were, or hear from them or anything. That was just their rules there. So he was completely shocked to get a letter from me. I had to write dear blank, not allowed to give him any details, but say thank you on blank. And he sent me a letter back as well saying I'd love to stay in touch. And he said, I work as a psychologist. I was like, oh, that's interesting. And he said, I'm so used to working with emotions and talking to people about feelings and dealing with all of that subject. But he said, but this had completely thrown me. Because he was just blown away that you got a letter from someone that he's potentially saved the life of. I mean, just a year post bone marrow transplant is still a little bit risky, so things still can go wrong. But after the second year, You're then allowed to swap details if you're still alive, obviously. You would have to swap details, and if he agrees and if I agree. So then he did agree. I found out his name, Thomas, and he lives in Berlin. And so I set up a meeting. I said, can I fly me and my mum over to Berlin and come and meet you? And it was the most emotional thing ever. I mean, he's enormous as well. Huge guy. And he lit a little tear as well. And he was just such a gentleman, so sweet. And he just gave me this tight hug and said it's the best thing he's ever done in his life. So it was just, so emotional. Amazing.
Wow. Well, as you were going through this, I'm sure you received a lot of support from your colleagues as well.
Amazing, actually. Yeah. Far and wide, which was lovely. Yeah.
I mean, that's such a difficult subject. I mean, of course, here in the States, we had Ryan Anthony working so hard for so long and such an inspiration to so many people. And whether any of us get it or not, we all know somebody who's dealing with it or has dealt with it. So I think your story is amazing. If people wanted to contribute to some of the places that you like to donate to or charitable, where would they go? What are your top picks?
There's Lymphoma Action. You can just Google that, or Cancer Research. I mean, they're the two charities that kind of supported me. Lymphoma Action, I mean, is the only charity for lymphoma. So, there's Hodgkin's, there's non-Hodgkin's, there's so much research still to be done. And thankfully, the drug that got me to remission was the first drug in 40 years to be FDA approved for use in treatment now. So I think that's being placed in the primary treatment for people that are diagnosed with it now in the UK. So hopefully people that have the weird stubborn type that I had will have more chance of survival right from the start, which is great. But down to Lymphoma Action, they've been the people that really championed the cause.
Wow. Well, once you got through that horrible nightmare, it's amazing that you could keep your spirits up so well dealing with all of that and keep bouncing back. There must have been a celebration once you finished, once you really knew you were in the clear, right?
You know what? I still haven't had that celebration because it was such a gradual, after the bone marrow transplant, I mean, I was learning to walk again. I was learning to eat again. I was learning to everything again. And because they've started your immune system from scratch, you've got to have all the childhood immunizations all over again. Mm-hmm. So I'm literally just turning 10 years old next month, actually. So it kind of feels like this year should be the celebration, really. 10 years.
What was it? Do you remember being on stage once you really got the okay? And what was that like?
You know, I don't think you don't really get an okay either because it's so gradual. Right. Just like you're doing okay, getting a bit better, a little bit stronger. Okay, we can now get rid of that drug. Carry on doing this. But you're on the anti-rejection drug for a long, long time. So it's kind of not like, there you go, you're in the clear, off you go. There's kind of none of that.
Yeah.
You don't really get that. But I think having survived the bone marrow transplant was my biggest moment, really, because that was the most difficult decision of my life. I remember having that month, and I remember asking my family, what should I do? And they said, we can't answer that. Well, what would you do? Can't answer that. All my friends answered exactly the same. And everyone said, we're just 100% behind you, whatever you choose. And I said, oh my God, what can I do? It was the only time I really felt alone with that decision. But having got through the bone marrow transplant, and then you're not really allowed abroad for the first year after the transplant because things can still go wrong and you're on so many drugs. An American tour came in, I think it was 9 or 10 months post-transplant. And my hair was just coming back, and I just said, I really want to go and do this tour. And my specialists were like, you're still having blood transfusions every 2 weeks? Yeah, but if I can fly back, halfway through, I said, yeah, will they do that? I'll ask. And they did. So I did the whole East Coast into Chicago and then flew home, blood pressure, and flew back and carried on.
Who was that with? Who was that tour
that
with?
That was Seal. That was Seal. He was just so sweet about that whole time. I think it was that first gig back on that tour. And I was eating again. I was getting stronger. I was playing the trombone again. I was doing backing vocals. I was back doing it. I was in America and I was like, okay, I'm on tour. This first gig is going to be emotional because I've survived that. Yeah, things could still go wrong, but things are looking good. And I remember the opening number was a backing vocals number. And then we come in with a ba 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 da da ba. And I just went, my voice is like, oh my God, I can't sing. I didn't realize you can't sing when you're crying. But your voice has gone, oh. So that was my sort of, emotional moment.
Wow. It's such an amazing story. And, it's hard to ask too many more questions after that kind of, all of
oh,
that.
No, it's fine.
No. It's just, it's such a tough journey and amazing you were able to really keep your spirits up and it's good you had such a great support network. So now I guess the next question would be, I mean, we've talked about your career and all the health issues. Kind of what's next for you? What do you have coming up? How are things in London, in England right now with the pandemic? I know it's a bit up and down.
There's some new variant going on at the moment, but I mean, I think we've got over half of the adult population now had their two vaccines, which is incredible. So I think there are a few areas that are struggling with more of this new variant, but it's mostly the younger generation that haven't yet had the vaccine. So I've been teaching online the whole time, so I've not really been doing anything in person, but things are just starting. Like I was meant to be on with the LSO this week, but I've got a few sessions coming in, so I'm actually gonna be getting on a train again, which is amazing. Things are starting up, and also I'm writing and recording a new album, which I'm excited about as well. This time I'm going, I know I've done a lot of sort of ballads and love being influenced by the Dick Nash and Tommy Dorsey and Herbie Green sound, string quartet and rhythm section. I've got a lot of that repertoire now and I love doing that as a solo concert. But this time I wanted to do something a bit different. So it's all electronic and pop and funk. So it's a bit different this time. And I'm about halfway through writing and recording all of that. So I'm hoping that's going to be out next spring.
Very good. Wow. Well, before we sign off, hang on just a second after I sign us off. But Carol, it's such a pleasure to talk to you and learn more about your story. It's amazing. And hopefully people will see you on stage and on television and things will be back to normal before we know it.
I hope we have normality everywhere in the world very soon. Thank you for having me on.
Thank you.